The UAW held its first special bargaining convention in 1958. It was a tumultuous time for the UAW and the nation. A worldwide recession was spreading. New car sales fell 31% in 1957, the worst year in sales since World War II. Unemployment was over 20% higher than the same period in 1956. These are unusual times, and that is why we have proposed an unusual approach, said President Walter Reuther before the 3,000 delegates attending the convention in Atlanta. One of the most controversial proposals at the convention turned out to be a negotiated profit-sharing plan. When the UAW said members deserve their share of company profits, corporate America went up in arms. In the week of the 1958 convention, Arizona Senator Barry Goldwater said, "Reuther and the UAW are more dangerous to our country than Sputnik or anything Soviet Russia might do." The following video is of an interview Reuther gave Mike Wallace the week of the 1958 UAW Special Bargaining Convention.
The Mike Wallace Interview. And now to our story. Yesterday here in Detroit, Walter Reuther and his United Auto Workers finished hammering out their plans for upcoming contract negotiations. Their demands will include increased unemployment benefits, an undisclosed but apparently substantial hourly wage hike, and most controversial, a profit-sharing plan that has outraged the big three, Chrysler, Ford, and General Motors. So the first question I'd like to put to you is this. What is the idea, the philosophy behind this profit-sharing demand? If your union wants more money, why doesn't it simply ask for higher wages, the way that unions have been doing all along? Why profit-sharing?
Well, we have proposed profit sharing for 1958 because we believe this is the most effective way to expand purchasing power. And purchasing power is the key to the economic future of the American economy. Our economy is in trouble. There's a serious and growing imbalance between expanding productive power and lagging purchasing power. And we believe that workers, consumers, and farmers are being shortchanged and that they are not getting their fair share of the fruits of our developing technology.
Well, I understand.
The giant corporations are getting more than their share. They're getting a disproportionately large share, and because they are keeping more than their proper share, this is creating this serious imbalance out of which unemployment and recession is developing.
Right.
Now, this is not only a matter of economic justice. This is a matter of economic necessity because our free economy will not work unless we maintain an expanding and dynamic balance between higher productive power balanced by higher purchasing power. And when one gets out of joint with the other, we get in trouble.
Mr. Reuther, let's come to the nub of the profit-sharing discussion, which is, in the minds of a good many people, it's been suggested by the heads of the big three and by numerous newspapers across the country that this is a Reuther giant step towards socialism. How do you react toward that charge?
Well, I react this way. I think this is perhaps the most pro-free enterprise demand that we have ever made. Because the only way you can make free enterprise secure is to give every American a stake in the fruits of its technology. And what we're proposing here is not a new idea, nothing revolutionary about. There are more than 20,000 companies in America that have profit-sharing plans. Two members of the Eisenhower cabinet, Mr. McElroy from Procter & Gamble, Mr. Folsom from Eastman Kodak, both of those companies have profit sharing.
But they were granted freely by the company, not asked for in bargaining demands by the union.
Principle. That doesn't change the basic principle. What's the difference, whether a worker shares in profits because the management thought about it, or whether he shares in profits because he thought about it? Does that change the principle?
Yes, indeed it does.
How does it change the principle?
And I think this comes to the principle of the whole thing. A man opens a store, or a man opens a company. He risks the money. He has the privilege, under our system of free private enterprise, does he not, of deciding what he is going to do with that money. It is not up to his workers to tell him what he should do.
Well, you'd have a very difficult job convincing Ford workers and Chrysler workers and General Motors workers who are unemployed that they don't risk anything, that they don't suffer loss when the company's in bad condition. They also suffer. But here's the thing you need to understand, that this principle is being applied in Ford, in General Motors, in Chrysler's. The executives are sharing in the profits. Now, they're not sharing in the profits as stockholders. They're sharing in the profits as employees.
Because they run the company.
But they're still employees. They're high-paid employees. But they are not getting profits They are not getting their profit bonus as stockholders. They're getting it as an employee.
Harlow Curtis makes his profits in a free enterprise system, manufacturing goods the public wants. Now, who is to decide what is to be done with that money? These profits in Harlow Curtis's pocketbook. Is the union to decide that, or is Harlow Curtis and the management of General Motors to decide?
They are not the property of Mr. Curtis. Mr. Curtis, in 1955, in addition to his $200,000 salary, got a bonus out of profits of $575,000. Now, what we would have gotten was roughly $600. And I say that if Mr. Curtis, because of his greater contribution, is entitled to, in addition to his salary, of a bonus out of excess profits of $575,000. Now, this he doesn't get as a stockholder. He gets this as an employee.
Mm-hmm.
That then why shouldn't a GM worker also share in the equity? Because he also contributes, perhaps not in the same measure.
Well, what does he contribute? Now, wait just a second.
He contributes his skill.
Wait just a moment.
Sweat.
I'm acting.
His intelligence.
Of course he does. Of course he does. And I'm acting only as devil's advocate here for just a moment. But I would like to put to you sensibly this question. A manager, first of all, collects the money, risks the money, has the imagination, has the courage, has the initiative, and then hires the workers to work for him. And what you're asking is that the workers who work for him should have the privilege of sharing in his...
Sure, but you're confusing the manager with the owner. Mr. Curtis doesn't own General Motors. He just works for it. He doesn't own the General Motors Corporation.
Well, up to now, I haven't seen the stockholders of General Motors suggesting a profit-sharing plan for employees, and they have the perfect right to suggest to Mr. Curtis that he not give himself that bonus.
Well, you see...
I imagine the stockholders of General Motors are fairly pleased with the way that General Motors has been operated under Mr. Curtis.
Well, it just so happens that every time we've asked for a new idea, we've been rejected. They rejected the pensions that we asked for several years ago. Why? Because they have operated on a double standard, economic and moral. We had a situation where we asked that $1.50 per hour employee get $100 per month pension. And they said it was wrong, it was morally wrong, it would undermine the independence and the self-respect of the worker. And yet, at that very time, the president of the General Motors Corporation was averaging, with his salary and his bonus, $332 per hour based upon a 40-hour week. Now, the company didn't think he could save on a measly $332 an hour, and they had created a pension of $25,000 a year for him.
Mr. Ruthie, you seem almost more interested in cutting down Harlow Curtis's take than increasing the take of the workers and the big three.
That is not true. The difference is this. I do not begrudge one penny Mr. Curtis gets. What I resent is that they try to deny the worker his fair equity, and they try to deny the consumer. And when they deny the worker and the consumer their equity, the system gets in trouble. It's in trouble now. Unemployment's on the increase. The industry is operating at 60%. The steel industry is operating at 60%. At the very time when America ought to have full employment and full production, making the things we need to meet the challenge in the world front and overcoming our domestic problems, we're limping along. So this is not just a matter of justice. This is a matter the system won't work.
All right, Walter Reuther. What is Reutherism?
Well, I'm not sure what Reutherism is, but I can tell you what I believe. I believe, to begin with, that free labor and free management have a great deal more in common than they have in conflict. And I believe that freedom is an indivisible value, that you can't have free labor without free management, and that we both need to learn to work and cooperate together to preserve our free society in a free world. You know, a few years from now, they'll be bragging about this, just as they brag about the pension plans they didn't want to give us, just as they brag about the other things they gave us at the bargaining table, only after we fought for them. I predict they'll talk about this one of these days in glowing terms.
The Mike Wallace Interview.